On this Independence Day edition of The World Over, award-winning actor and philanthropist Gary Sinise joins us to celebrate the 10th anniversary of his foundation and its work serving our nation's veterans and first responders. China has been under communist rule for 100 years this July, but do its people have any cause for celebration given their human rights and religious liberty record? Notre Dame professor of political science Victoria Huey is here with analysis. And Grammy-winning recording artist JOSE FELICIANO tells us the story of his inspiring single, I'm America. Finally, some classic world-over interviews with American heroes to remind us of the cost of freedom and the power of faith. Lieutenant General Hal Moore and Admiral Jeremiah Denton. A very important world-over begins right now.
Now, Raymond Arroyo.
A warm welcome to all of you joining us in the United States and the world over. Happy Independence Day. We've got a terrific show for you tonight. If you'd like to comment, send me a tweet. I'm at Raymond Arroyo. Lots to cover. Let's get right to it. My first guest was nominated for an Oscar for his role as Lieutenant Dan in the 1994 blockbuster Forrest Gump. He's an Emmy winner, a family man, musician, philanthropist, working on behalf of our nation's fighting men and women. He and his foundation provide assistance to our veterans and first responders in need, and they're celebrating their 10th anniversary this year. He joins us tonight to celebrate our nation's birth and 10 years of the Gary Sinise Foundation. Please welcome the man himself, Gary Sinise. Thanks for being here, Gary.
Thank you, Raymond. Good to be with you.
Great to see you. Look, first of all, congratulations on 10 years of the foundation and its incredible work. How do you process this in retrospect, all the lives that have been touched through the foundation's initiatives?
Oh, gosh, it's extraordinary. We couldn't do it without the generosity and passionate heart for our defenders that without the American people. The American people support the Gary Sinise Foundation. Years ago, when we launched, 10 years ago exactly, there was one donor. And we were just opening up the website and just going public with the foundation and just starting to take in donations. It started out slowly. But as the years have rolled on here, we've just got thousands and thousands of generous people that care about our defenders, and without them, we couldn't do the extraordinary things that we're doing right now. And the foundation has just grown and grown over these last 10 years, so much so that our programs have just expanded. We've built multiple homes for our wounded, and we have several initiatives within those four pillar programs that we have that operate all over the country, trying to serve and honor the needs of the men and women who serve our country. We're very grateful to them. I'm a grateful American for them, and I just want to show my support by offering this this means to the American people to support them through the Gary Sinise Foundation.
Gary, I want to talk about some of the best-known work of your foundation. Your organization has given so much to our nation's wounded warriors, particularly through the RISE program, Restoring Independence, Supporting Empowerment. Now, that has continued to change lives for injured vets and their families. As you mentioned, you all have now donated over 70 specially equipped smart houses for these wounded heroes and retrofitted another 60 existing homes. In May of this year, you donated your 71st home to a badly injured Navy bomb technician, Kenton Stacy, in Poway, California. Tell me about Kenton and this latest project and what it means to you personally, because I know you often go and open up the home and bring these warriors home.
Well, it's a beautiful thing. I started, it's over 10 years now, since I raised money to help build the first home, which started the ball rolling here in terms of these specially adapted smart technology houses. I could see that in the initial stages, the benefits to having a home for somebody who's very, very severely wounded and specially designed for them to meet the challenges, their challenges physically, and what it can do for the families as well, right, to restore independence not only to the warrior but to the families. And Kenton, he was an EOD technician, joined the Navy, and unfortunately an IED went off and it paralyzed him from the neck down. He's a quadriplegic. He's blind in his left eye. He's got a family. Obviously, special needs. His wife is his caregiver by his side constantly. And so we wanted to provide this smart technology for them to help them with their independence. And it's helped not only Kenton to have a more independent life, but the family as well.
Yeah. The foundation does such incredible work. And again, when you look at these men and women, I mean, I know a family in Louisiana that you all gifted a home to. And the life-changing aspects of that, I think we don't fully appreciate, because we send these men and women off to war. They come home. And then in many cases, Americans forget about them and the sacrifice that they made in the field, and they continue to make in the homeland. You all don't. And I love that you're engaged in all aspects of their lives. I was privileged to be with you all during the Snowball Express, which is an annual program you run. And it focuses on children of Gold Star families who've lost loved ones. You partner with American Airlines and you give these children and their families a trip away, a little needed fun and healing for a long week or weekend. We went to Disney World a couple of years ago. Gary, tell me, give people a sense of what these trips mean to those families and how consoling, what a relief it is to them who have lost so much.
Oh, we've had extraordinary events over the years with our Snowball Express program. This was something that was started back in 2006, and the guys that started it approached me after that first event, and they knew I was supporting the military and going out for the USO and raising money and whatnot. Right. Came to me and they showed me a video of the first event that was held at Disneyland, and I fell in love with the cause, the issue, which was to bring hope and healing to the families and especially the children of our fallen heroes, and take them to the happiest place on earth right before Christmas time. You know, the holidays can be very, very difficult for a child who's lost a parent. And so bringing them all together, where each child from various places around the country can meet other children that are going through the same thing, it became so uplifting and rewarding for the families to see the mothers, surviving spouses, seeing the children just being lifted up by meeting other children. And it was certainly uplifting to all of us who are volunteering our time to try to help these children. And eventually, after years and years of doing it and bringing my band to play for the kids every year and that kind of thing, we folded Snowball Express into the Gary Sinise Foundation, because we wanted to move the event. It had started at Disneyland, then it moved to Dallas, which is where American Airlines is based, and we did it there for many years. And then we wanted to move it to Orlando and do it at Disney World. We needed to raise some extra money, and we thought a way to do that would be to fold it in as a program of the Gary Sinise Foundation. And that was when you came down and saw what we were doing. And you know, this is something that I've done many, many years. It's uplifting, as I said, for the children and families to get together with each other in a place, you know, it's all about happiness and healing.
And so many of them, Gary, told me, both the parents as well as the children, they were meeting people who've gone through what they went through, and they forged bonds that are as strong as a family, really, and they look forward to seeing each other not only each year at the Snowball Express, but outside of it. They meet personally and outside of your foundation. So those friendships, those connections, I think, are so important, as you said, not only for their healing, but for their sustenance and understanding of what the other is going through. Now, the mental health of our veterans, I know, is always an important consideration for you. Suicide has become a national epidemic among our armed forces community. According to 2019 statistics from the VA, veterans are nearly twice as likely to commit suicide than non-vets. It's heartbreaking. And you recently announced a major new initiative to support the mental wellness of our country's heroes. Tell us about the Avalon Network. What is it?
Well, the Avalon Network is a group of partners that have come together to expand services, mental wellness services for our veterans. This is a very serious problem, and it's sometimes nearly impossible to recognize the signs. I mean, you've all heard, the family members or the friends of somebody who's taken their own life say, I just never knew. He never let on, or she never said anything. And so it's sometimes very, very difficult to recognize. But by providing this network of services through the Marcus Institute for Brain Health and Boulder Crest Retreats, this is a clinic and a retreat environment that's specifically designed to meet those mental wellness challenges through something that we call post-traumatic growth, where we believe that we can, it's a science, and we believe that we can really turn a post-traumatic event into personal growth with the right tools in the right environment. And that's why we're providing a series of clinics around the country and retreats modeled after both the Marcus Institute for Brain Health in Denver and Boulder Crest Retreats, which was started back in 2003. And there's retreats now in Bluemont, Virginia, and right outside of Tucson. And now we're expanding those services to incorporate the programs that are at these places in other retreat environments. And we're funding that through the Avalon Network, the Gary Sinise Foundation Avalon Network, supported by great partners like Bernie Marcus and Arthur Blank, both co-founders of Home Depot, who have really extended themselves and their philanthropy toward helping our veterans through this network.
Yeah, so important. It's a very important work. Gary, I want to talk about you personally for a second. You kind of got into this work via the Lieutenant Dan Band, correct? I mean, you've been performing for troops for, what, 18 years now?
It's been a long time. I mean, there were several factors that led to my getting so involved. I am veterans of my own family, and then I got my wife has two brothers who served in Vietnam, and a sister whose husband served in Vietnam. Lots of veterans in my family, and it was really the Vietnam veterans who came home from war to a nation that was divided, a nation that turned its back on the returning Vietnam veteran, and them having to basically hide that they served at all because the nation was so torn apart over that war. The Vietnam veterans suffered for it. And then when we deployed to Iraq and Afghanistan, I just didn't want to see that happen to our returning warriors coming home from Afghanistan and Iraq. So I started going out for the USO and started taking my band and started going to the hospitals and supporting various nonprofits. And then I started my own nonprofit, the Gary Sinise Foundation, 10 years ago.
Yeah. What role did your faith play in all of this, Gary? And what role does it play? I mean, this is really a corporal work of mercy that you're doing every day through the foundation.
You were so kind to have me on your show when my book came out a couple of years ago, Grateful American, A Journey from Self to Service. And there is a chapter in that book called Turning Point. And it really, you know, the first part of the book is all kind of a setup in a sense to what would happen to me after September 11th, 2001, when I just felt called to service and called to support the men and women who were deploying in response to that horrible event. And so I remember I told this story before, Raymond, to you, standing in our small Catholic church and listening to the homily on the National Day of Prayer, the Friday after the Tuesday of the attack of September 11th. And all the churches and houses of worship around the country were just filled that day. And I was standing room only. I was standing up against the side of the wall. And I felt called to do something. My heart was broken, like so many of us, from those images of the towers coming down and the Pentagon and Shanksville and the loss of life. And then our troops started winding up. A month later, they deployed to Afghanistan. They started getting hurt, and I just felt called to do something. I really feel like God was saying, you know, you've had a blessed life. You've been successful in your career. You've got means. You've got a public platform. You have finances. Do some good with it. And therefore, I just started going out there, and it was really healing to be able to serve. Service is a great healer, for sure.
Yeah. What have those vets, Gary, in our final moments, what have they taught you about freedom, and has it enriched and deepened your Independence Day each year?
Well, you know, freedom is not something that everyone on this planet enjoys, When you travel around the world and you go to places, war zones, you know, places that have been under the thumb of a dictator, and there are places around the world that still do not enjoy freedom. So when you go to places like that, you see other societies that really don't understand what freedom is. You value your freedom that much more, and you value those who provide it all the more. And it has to be fought for and protected. That's just the way the world works. Somebody's got to defend freedom. Somebody has to provide security for you. Somebody has to race in the burning building and try to rescue somebody. Somebody has to show up when there are difficult things, difficult dangers. And I'm thankful to the men and women who do show up, and I want to do everything I can to back them up.
Well, thank you for your important work, and happy July 4th. We'll check in with you soon, Gary, and I know certainly my prayers and that of the audience are with you, but more than that, I hope you will support and help advance the work of the Gary Sinise Foundation. Go to GarySiniseFoundation.org. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you, Raymond.
As Gary said there, you really appreciate freedom when you see or experience its absence. China is commemorating a century of Chinese communist rule with an array of public events and dramatic celebrations, but unmentioned is its crackdown on the freedom of speech and religion. Joining me now to discuss what's happening in her native Hong Kong and the mainland, U.S.-China relations, and much more, is Associate Professor of Political Science at the University of Notre Dame, Victoria Hoy. Professor Hoy, as I mentioned, July 1st marks the 100th anniversary of the Chinese Communist Party. The CCP is celebrating this moment in a big way. How important is this commemoration for President Xi?
You are quite right that it's actually the significance is to Xi Jinping personally, more that to the party, because Xi Jinping thinks that he represents the party. And when he first came to office, he talked about the China dream of becoming big and powerful and prosperous, rivaling the United States. Essentially, this has to be done under his watch. his dream is actually to become the greatest leader of all times in true Chinese history. And so a lot of the poems, a lot of the celebrations essentially really contributes to glorifying him himself, much less the party.
The New York Times covered a new propaganda theme park that the Chinese just opened. It's meant to reinforce devotion to the Communist Party. Obviously, it sanitizes history. It even features a simulator where children can shoot invaders. How does this mindset compare with what we're seeing here in the United States, Professor? A destruction, even a revulsion at our own history and of our own history.
So Chinese leaders like to say that, you know, who are you Americans to criticize our human rights situation? Look at what you've been doing to, for example, minorities. Look at what you did to Native Indians. The thing is that in the United States, there are certainly attempts to whitewash history. But at the same time, you also have a huge chunk of the population who wants to really restore and rediscover and talk about the, you know, dark sides of American history. What is happening in China is that they want to whitewash everything. And those who refuse to whitewash, those who talk about China, you know, all of those human rights problems and repression of minorities, they are seen as enemies of the people. They have to be cracked down, all dissenting voices, and not tolerated. So this is the big difference. And it is also striking that, you know, if even young people are encouraged to shoot guns, this also, so China wants to have this new diplomacy that we want to look like we are lovable, but at the same time, they also want to show how powerful they are. And therefore, these two messages actually go against each other.
Yeah, I'm always tickled by the American sports stars with all these endorsements, you know, for Nike and these other companies that do business with China. And they often praise China while degrading their own country. But, you know, if they lived in China, they'd find trying to criticize the home country wouldn't go down so well. At the G7 summit last month, President Biden urged European nations to call out China on abuses. Instead, the group issued a rather tame statement that encouraged China to, quote, respect human rights and fundamental freedoms, end quote. Your reaction to the G7 stance here, does this achieve anything at all, Professor Hoy?
Well, so essentially, this is the difficulty of calling out human rights abuses in China, is because the rest of the world still benefits so much from China's economy, or at least they think that, a lot of these businesses think that they are dependent on the Chinese economy, on the China market, on Chinese investment, on even Chinese vaccines. In a way, this is a mistake because China is just as dependent on the United States. The entire China's meteoric rise in the last two decades is all dependent on its ability to sell to the United States or to sometimes steal technology prototypes from American companies. It is really sad that so many companies and even European governments continue to think that, you know, they're dependent on China. But that statement is the first step.
The front runner to succeed German Chancellor Angela Merkel in a recent interview said, quote, the question is, if we're talking about restraining China, will that lead to a new conflict? Do we need a new adversary? China is a competitor and a systemic rival. It has a different model of society, and it's also a partner, particularly in things like fighting climate change, end quote. Is climate change really what needs to be addressed here, Professor, given China's track record on human rights abuses, et cetera?
I think that Kerry is good that, you know, now that he's in charge of climate change diplomacy, I think he is taking the right position. In the old days, there was this idea that, you know, there are all these global problems that require China's cooperation. And therefore, well, you know, the environment is essentially the number one threat to humanity. Human rights abuses, yes, they're important, but they may take a backseat. But what Kerry's new position is that climate change is important, but at the same time, it's actually China is not doing the rest of the world any favor in working with the rest of the world. China itself according to a lot of estimates, environmental degradation costs China several points of its GDP per year. Its river runs black, its mountains get chipped off. And so the rest of the world should really understand that, you know, we should continue to press China on environmental cooperation as well as on other important issues.
Mm-hmm. Well, the question is, what are the instruments of that pressure? How do you pressure them? Would you suggest, as the United States did for years with Russia, simply cutting off trade with China until it reforms itself? As you said, they're very reliant on the United States market as much as many United States companies are reliant on the Chinese market.
This is a good point, but what is interesting is that in the last two years, there was so much talk about the administration decoupling the U.S. and the Chinese economy. But what we also should note is that it's actually the Chinese government that is really decoupling a lot of companies from the rest of the world. Think about it. You know, Nike just declared that it is for China of China. Essentially, companies are forced to choose. Do you follow U.S. rules or do you follow Chinese rules? And so these companies, when they are forced to choose, essentially China is creating a different set of rules, essentially creating this line. We are seeing a new Cold War, in a way, to a large extent, it is actually China's own making. And so what could the United States or the rest of the world do? Insist on, you know, upholding values. Maybe at the same time, the hardest obstacle is all these companies continue to think that they can make money in China. Maybe consumers in the United States, in Europe, should try to emphasize that you want to make money in China, then you cannot make money from us. And the markets in the United States and European countries and democracies combined are much bigger than China itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, an important key point. Last week, the United Nations Human Rights Council released a joint statement. It was signed by 44 countries, and they urged China to allow independent observers into Xinjiang, where imprisonment and mistreatment of Uyghurs have been widely reported. Now, China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs spokesman says this is prying into China's internal affairs. Your thoughts?
Yeah, so China actually has been very successful at telling the rest of the world that repression in Tibet is internal affairs. Genocide, concentration camps in Xinjiang, that's internal affairs. Repression in Hong Kong, violation of the one country, two systems model, internal affairs. Even when it plans to take over Taiwan, it is all internal affairs. The fact that, you know, we also have a democratic peace theory. What you do to your own people, what you do to your own neighbors, is a sign of how you would treat the rest of the world. So this is why that, you know, whatever China is doing to its own people already has resonance with the rest of the world. It's just that they cannot literally lock up Americans, not if they are on American soil, but they have issued arrest warrants to Americans who champion for a boycott, who champion for, you know, imposing sanctions on Chinese officials. So, you know, what they do as internal affairs really has international ramifications, and that is already the reality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Ukraine, which signed that, was a signatory to that plea to the Chinese to allow independent observers in. China threatened their COVID vaccinations from coming in, and Ukraine pulled their name from that request. So it again shows they're playing hardball. In the meantime, the Chinese government has engaged in a major propaganda campaign. The New York Times and ProPublica uncovered the CCP flooding YouTube, Twitter, TikTok with more than 3,000 videos. And in them, Chinese citizens purportedly deny abuses against their own communities, and they scold foreign officials and corporations who dare question the Chinese government's human rights record. Your reaction to this, what do you make of this campaign? And how should the United States respond, Professor?
It is very sad that people are not just repressed, people are not just locked up. China has this practice of making the arrested make televised confessions. This is kind of an extension to that. Is it to make these people, not just that, you know, maybe even their loved ones are arrested, or maybe these people themselves are actually in jail, but you may get a little bit better treatment if you actually say on video that everything is great, the rest of the world are just, you know, the United States is just evil. Mm-hmm. In a way, there is not a whole lot other governments can do other than protecting their own citizens when China's long arm reaches them. But at the same time, there's also this coalescing of support to boycott the Beijing Winter Olympics in 2022. Again, this may not mean a whole lot, going back to, you know, because China still thinks that it has a lot of economic coercive power. But China loves legitimacy. It wants to do all of those things and have the cake and eat it too. It wants to tell a story that it is a great person, it is a great leader. And so denying China legitimacy, that is also an important step. In addition to, you know, American companies making the right choice.
Right. I want to move on to Hong Kong. You're a Hong Kong native. You've been watching, as we all have, these crackdowns that have taken place there over the last 2 years. Last week, we saw the closure of Apple Daily, the last free press, really, in Hong Kong, founded by Jimmy Lai, who has been in prison since August of last year. What should the U.S. be doing about the suppression and repression of Hong Kong? And frankly, the Vatican as well, Professor. We've heard nothing from the Holy See about this ongoing personal and religious oppression of the people in Hong Kong and throughout mainland China.
I am so glad that you bring the two issues together, because a lot of people don't see them in, you know, in what you talk about them in the same sentence. With the forced closure of the Apple Daily, that was the only pro-democracy print newspaper. And it is also important to realize that it is a listed company. So the government can actually kill a listed company by freezing its accounts and then arresting the publisher and six top executives, actually seven as of today, top executives and editors-in-chief. This is very scary. What does it mean? Again, if Beijing wants Hong Kong to remain an international financial center, a lot of companies are going to think twice. And Citibank, along with HSBC, were involved in freezing, were told to freeze the Apple Daily accounts, and they follow. And Citibank, again, has to choose, do you want to follow Chinese rules or American laws? At the same time, you're quite right that the Holy See has said little. In Hong Kong, a lot of the Catholics are pro-democracy, including the Archbishop Zen. And he has been championing that, you know, the Holy See should not sign this secret deal with Beijing. But what the Vatican has been doing is to actually shut him up. He feels very, very sad. And some of the arrested are very prominent Catholics in Hong Kong. And also that long before any of these protests, many decades, even 2 decades ago, before any of those protests emerged, Beijing was already seeing religious freedom in Hong Kong as a prime target. And so, you know, the Holy See is making a huge mistake in ignoring all of that.
No, it's a tragedy. And I did not know that about Citibank. I didn't realize it was Citibank that froze Apple Daily's accounts and, I imagine, Jimmy Lai's accounts. But that's an important bit of information for people watching around the world, whether you want to do business with a company like that.
Exactly. So in a way, it's going back to what you said about, you know, are we creating conflicts? In a way, it is really China that is forcing companies to choose. We have built up a globalized world, an integrated economic, a global order. But yet it is China that is really forcing people to choose. So creating this new velvet line, creating the next Cold War.
No, they've got the American companies and need to pull out, and European companies need to pull out of Hong Kong. They can't do business with a regime like this. It's just, you talk about an evil empire. That's what's happening here. Look, the first U.S.-Taiwan trade talks are taking place this week. Beijing has called on the U.S. to stop any form of official exchanges with Taiwan. During a press briefing earlier this week, White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki had this to say.
Our support for Taiwan is rock solid. Taiwan is a leading democracy, a major economy, and a security partner. and we will continue to strengthen our relationship across all the areas we cooperate, including on economic issues.
Professor, could China move on Taiwan the way they've moved on Hong Kong? And do you expect the U.S. to continue to stand by Taiwan?
This is a very significant development in a way that the rest of the world cannot really do a whole lot when it comes to genocide in Xinjiang, very brutal repression in Tibet, and also this increasingly brutal repression in Hong Kong. But Taiwan so far is still semi, it is still de facto independent. And at the same time for Xi Jinping, he wants to, his China dream is to achieve grand unity. After Hong Kong, Taiwan is next. So the Biden administration is doing exactly the right thing, that the best way to deter China from, quote unquote, reunifying Taiwan by force is to make sure that we're going to be there if you make your next move. We also know that Xi Jinping, you know, Chinese leaders, they make calculations. They know that if there's actual war, then the chance is 50-50. U.S. naval commanders, they lament that, you know, if there's an actual war, they are not sure if they can win, and China may well be able to win because China can deploy all its resources focusing on the Western Pacific, whereas U.S. Military is all scattered around the world. But if the U.S. makes an increasingly strong commitment, turning the old strategy ambiguity into strategy clarity, then Beijing leaders will think twice. So this is really a welcoming move.
Professor Victoria Hoy, I thank you so much for being here. You can learn more about Voices for Hong Kong at hkdc.us. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
And now for something a bit more uplifting. He's a Grammy Award-winning recording artist who, over five decades, has become a beloved American icon. I spoke with him about the inspiring and timely I'm America, his latest single, from his album, Behind This Guitar. To help us celebrate Independence Day weekend, here's my exclusive interview with JOSE FELICIANO. Thank you for being with us, JOSE.
Raymond, it's my extreme pleasure. One, since I've been an admirer of yours for quite a while, and a lot of times when I haven't been, let's say, on the straight and narrow, there's Raymond Arroyo grabbing me by the collar and saying, "Shut up, boy." So here we are.
Well, I love you back. You know that. Look, it's great to have you here. I want to ask you about this new single and the video, I'm America. Now, originally, this was from your most recent album, Behind This Guitar. Where did the track come from? And why did you want to record it, JOSE?
Well, the track came from my esteemed colleague, Rick Gerard, who has been recording with me for the longest time. We recorded Light My Fire. It was Rick Gerard who said to me, "JOSE, why don't you write a Christmas song?" And I have to say, when he suggested that to me, it was like being punched in the stomach, because how could I write a song as good as White Christmas or all the other great Christmas songs? And then I started just playing a few notes on the guitar. I was singing, "Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad." And, you know, and I kept on singing, and I said, "Rick, nobody's gonna like a song like this." And Rick said to me, "Try it anyway. Let's go in the studio and record it." And so I recorded it with my Brazilian drummer at the time, Paulino Magalhães. I played, I'm kind of like a Paul McCartney in the sense that I play more than one instrument. So I recorded all the tracks. And when he got one of Bing Crosby's arrangers and guitarist, Perry Botkin Jr., I couldn't believe what came out. And I was so thrilled. And I did it in two languages, that I could teach English people how to speak Spanish, and I could teach Spanish people how to speak English, because Spanish people are very shy when it comes to languages.
Mm-hmm. Well, and we've been singing Feliz Navidad ever since. Now, I want to give the audience a taste of this new song, because as you said, your producer is back with you. This is like the Beatles coming back together. I want to share this new song with everybody. Because of these unprecedented world events and the pandemic, I know all of that inspired you to record a new version of this song. Here is Jose Feliciano and the Virginia Union University Choir singing I'm America. Listen.
I'm the river, I'm the rain, the lonesome whistle of a train. I'm the amber waves of a grain. I'm the highway, I'm the farm, the fertile fields and boulevards, the hand that rests over your heart. Oh, I'm the echo of the bell that's ringing. Oh, I'm the freedom in the song we're singing. I'm the seed that's in the dust. I'm the prayer in God we trust. The place to dream for all of us. I'm America. Oh, yes, I am. Window to a chance, the place where courage takes a stance.
All the colors that you see,
the lights from 30,000 feet, yeah, on the roar of victory.
Oh,
I'm the echo of the bell that's ringing.
Oh,
I'm the freedom in the song.
How did it feel to rediscover this song during the shutdown and the events that have followed, Jose? And did the meaning of the song change for you?
No, because I've always loved America. I'm just happy that I could be in a country that is still free. And the only thing I want to say is I hope this interview gets other people to love America as much as I do, because I love this country very much.
Yeah. Well, you see that, and you hear it in the track. It's so personal, and yet inclusive of everybody. Now, not only do you have the new record and the new single out, there's also a documentary coming out behind this guitar, coming out soon. It's an overview of your 50-year career. It includes a moment from the 1968 World Series in Detroit when you sang the national anthem, putting your own spin on that classic melody. The response, Jose, was a little brutal. Here's a clip from the documentary.
This Puerto Rican Latino has messed with our national anthem. He's thinking 250 million people hate me.
He played it more negro. More black. Back then, people who were not ready, they're probably still not ready now.
In the 60s, being commercial, particularly on something as traditional as the Star Spangled Banner, was really kind of a kiss of death.
Had Jose come out and just done your typical anthem, he wouldn't have created something and opened the door for artists that then did the anthem in their way.
He did something that was very Jose Feliciano. He was honest. He was never lack of respect. I don't think nobody loved this country more than him.
Jose, what did you think when you heard the reaction to your version of the anthem? I mean, you really were a trailblazer. You gave Whitney Houston and Ray Charles and so many others permission to interpret the national anthem in their own way.
Well, I didn't realize that I was a pioneer, and pioneers don't always get the accolades and the praises, because we're, you know, like when Neil Armstrong walked on the moon, after him, everybody else was just everybody else. Whereas Neil Armstrong was our boy. He was our buddy. He was the one that risked his life and did something that all we ever did was talk about.
Mm-hmm. Jose, given the tension and the chaos in the country right now, it feels in some ways like 1968, the tearing down of monuments, the suggestion that the anthem that you sang is racist and should be changed. What are your thoughts, and what is America to you now?
America to me now is the same it's always been, a wonderful, great country.
Do you miss the road during this pandemic, Jose?
Truthfully, I miss the audiences, but I don't miss it because I've been with my wife a lot more now than I used to be. So I'm just proud to be home, to be with my wife and kids. And I'm hoping that soon I will be able to travel, because truthfully, I miss the input of my fans.
Mm-hmm. Now, that anthem controversy, it did change your life in a significant way. You referenced it a moment ago. It inspired a girl named Susan to start a Feliciano fan club and inspired a romance. Tell us quickly about that.
Well, Susan started a fan club for me because she was defending me and what I did and my right to do what I did. And I love her for it, and here we are.
36 years of marriage, amazing.
That's quite a long time, you know.
You bet.
It's been a good marriage. I have three kids, and I have two boys and a girl. And the two boys are musicians, and we used to have a band called Two Kids and a Blind Guy.
Well, I'll bet you sounded great, too. What's your message to America on this July 4th weekend, Jose?
My message to America on this July 4th is be happy with the country that we have. And instead of complaining about it, let's make it better for all of us.
I'm America by Jose Feliciano. From the album Behind This Guitar is available at josefeliciano.com and all the usual outlets. On Independence Day, I think it important for us to focus on those who've given so much to protect our freedoms. First up, he was a Korean War veteran and commander of the first U.S. engagement of the Vietnam War. Lieutenant General Hal Moore was a true leader, respected by his men and by his enemies. He was a West Point grad, an author, a beloved husband and father. Mel Gibson immortalized him on the big screen in We Were Soldiers, based on General Moore's memoirs. Hal Moore passed away in February of 2017. But here are some highlights of our conversation in Washington, D.C. in 2008. We talked about the faith so important to his service as well as his life. Take a look.
I was born in a Catholic family in a small town in Kentucky. I was raised by Catholic teachers through the eighth grade by the nuns of St. Francis Xavier, by the Sisters of Charity. And then I went to St. Joseph Prep School, run by the Brothers of St. Francis Xavier. I went to Mass almost every day. And then when I went to West Point, I was so dumb at West Point that the only reason that I got through West Point was going to Mass almost daily and praying to God to help me get through West Point. But I'm proud to say that I graduated at the top of the bottom 20% of my class.
All right, that a boy. You were right there with me. We were in the same class. You had a Father Murdoch who was your spiritual director and kind of mentor at West Point. What influence did he have on you?
I became very close friends with Father Murdoch all through my years at West Point. I was very dumb in mathematics, which was is based on West Point was based on mathematics in those days. And I had to study late at night till 2-3 o'clock in the morning. And I went to Mass every morning at 6:30, and that's when you had to fast the night before. You couldn't eat before communion. But I went to Mass every morning at 7 o'clock, 20-minute Mass by Father Murdoch, and that got me through West Point. And all through my life, I have tried to keep fresh in my mind that the whole purpose of life on earth is to qualify for life hereafter in heaven with our Father in heaven.
Lieutenant General Hal Moore, what a great man, what an example. And here's another one. Admiral Jeremiah Denton was shot down by the North Vietnamese in 1965. He spent 8 years as a captive in the notorious Hanoi Hilton prison. He famously blinked the word torture in Morse code during an orchestrated propaganda broadcast in 1966. Denton exemplified bravery, heroism, ingenuity, and sacrifice, which was shown by our American POWs throughout the Vietnam War. I sat down with him a few years ago in our Birmingham studios to talk about what his service meant to him and the faith that was crucial to his survival. Here's a bit of my interview with late Rear Admiral and former U.S. Senator from Alabama, Jeremiah Denton.
Tell me about there was a rig they instituted in your cell for 5 days.
There were so many rigs. It's kind of complicated. The one you're talking about is when I surrendered to God.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to describe. I was down to about 120 pounds at that point. I didn't have any meat on my butt, so I was sitting on this concrete bed with my ankles in stocks and my hands handcuffed behind me in what they called hell cuffs, which is very painful, a gag in my mouth and blindfolded, and they had a rig under my ankles, under my Achilles tendons was a bar which they could pull on from above on a pulley and push it into my Achilles tendons, and it couldn't go anywhere because my legs are in irons on the top. And
so it would just eat away at the Achilles tendon eventually.
Right. They got almost halfway through mine. I surrendered after 5 days and nights thinking that they would accept some bland lie, some truths they already knew. They wanted to know what our camp communications was. I was a camp commander. If we had lost those communications, they were very complex, countermeasure type thing we've been working on for a long time. We were heavily relying on it for morale and order and discipline.
Right.
The chain of command. I wasn't about to give it. But I said, bow cow, I surrendered. They took me in and I wrote a bunch of stuff they already knew. And I thought, well, they're going to let me go because they don't want me to die. That was the key. Mm-hmm. You had to convince them that your life, they had to take your life. They didn't want to kill us. They wanted to save us and exploit us. So, to my surprise and dismay, they put me back in the rig. And it got pretty hopeless. I couldn't think. I couldn't pray anymore. And I said to God, it's not easy to say, expressed with my whole being, I can't think of anything else to pray. I can't think of any recited prayers. I can't think of any spontaneous prayers. I'm in a desperate situation. If anything happens good out of this, it's going to be yours. You got it. You got me. You got everything about me. The instant I said that, I had been going through alternating periods of feeling heat and feeling chills. I was shaking at that time, and you could hear my chains around the camp. And the instant I willed that, it was like a blanket of warmth just a whole aura of composure, of no pain. The pain was immediate release, which was in my back. That was the principal part of the pain. And I just went from fear, anxiety, almost an unendurable pain, to complete comfort and assurance and no fear. A few minutes later, the guard came in, the camp commander. This is the only time I know that this happened. The camp commander himself came, a guy we call the Lump. He was a pretty senior guide. He came with the two guards and told him to go in there and break Denton. Break his legs if you have to, but break him. Mm-hmm. And he was screaming. He was screaming at them. They came in, and one of the boys was about 19 years old, pretty good kid. We called him Smiley. He did his duty. He tortured, but I don't think he liked it. At any rate, he and the other guard started pulling on his pulley. Mm-hmm. And I just looked at Smiley with a smile, expressing what was in me. I don't hurt. You're not going to break me, and you're not a bad guy. How can you do this to another human being? Mm. His face broke, contorted, tears. He yanked the other guard off the pulley and went outside and started screaming at the camp commander. He wasn't going to do that anymore. They're going to have to find somebody else. Huh. And 20 minutes later, they came in and put sulfa on my open wounds, released the rig, and carried me out to an isolated place where I supposedly couldn't tell the other guys I hadn't given in.
Your faith and your honor.
That
really
was a miracle to me.
Yeah. Your faith and your honor really fused in that experience, in all your experience in this time.
I don't
time.
Know why you're throwing honor in there, but faith, yes. Faith, that was the most terrific product of a prayer, of an answer to a prayer that I ever gotten. Mm-hmm. But all the way through prison, it was like that. They say, you know, anybody in pain or suffering is going to pray. No atheists in foxholes. Some woman with a difficult delivery. They're going to pray, and they're going to get relief of some kind. God's going to help them in some way. Right. And we had so many examples of that because we were under such constant pressure and pain and suffering and fear that we prayed a lot, and we got a lot of answers. And there's nothing new about that. It's throughout the history of the world and in most everybody's lives. And so I don't like to be, you know, praised for receiving grace from God. You always do.
But you cooperated with it, and you understood it when it was going on. And some people don't. They waste that suffering. They waste that pain.
Well, I don't know about that. But I think most people cooperate when they're in pain and they're getting help.
Admiral, at this point, tell me how freedom, what freedom means to you after this experience, and faith, and how they're really bound in your mind.
Well, before the experience, intensely during the experience, and intensely after the experience, I've devoted a lot of thought to the relationship between faith and freedom. Mm-hmm. If you go back to Athens, the first time democracy was really tried, and darn near the last, because the next time it was Switzerland, and they didn't really complete their democracy the way we did. But in Athens, it failed. It became a classic example, which indicated to the political world, the political science world, that democracy won't work. Sooner or later, the people just can't handle it. They get to the point where demagogues, which is a word that came in then, mm-hmm. can, knowing that they all have special interests, can demagogically talk to them, get them in groups, mess up the unity of the country,
right.
Promise them things that they can't afford for the state to give. And in other words, they lack self-discipline and compassion. They're trying to be, they're just greedy. That's us. We're greedy. But if you have the self-discipline and compassion, let's say it's morality, our founding fathers realized that if you have sufficient self-discipline and compassion, they knew that morality was necessary. And I'd like to read a quote from George Washington because it's so darn important. It takes about, this is what our government ought to read now. Of all the dispositions and habits which lead to political prosperity, religion and morals are indispensable supports. Let us with caution indulge the supposition that morality can be maintained without religion. Whatever may be conceded to the influence of refined education on minds of peculiar stature, both reason and experience forbid us to expect that national morality can prevail in exclusion of religious principle.
Gerry Denton, an incredible man, a dear friend, and a great time. May he rest in peace. I want to wish you all a very happy Independence Day weekend, and I hope this broadcast has helped you not only to celebrate our freedoms, but to recall those who sacrificed so much to secure them. May God bless all our men and women in the armed services and their families who give up so much day in and day out. That's all the time we have for now. Be sure to catch us next week. Until then, we'll be scouting the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thank you for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo. Bye now.